Welcome to Filter Hose. This is our introductory video, mainly intended to help you get oriented with the interface and get started with building FIR filters. If you haven't already maximized the window, go ahead and do that. You'll be able to see the detail in the graphs better, where you can adjust it to whatever size suits your needs. On the right side, there are six graphs. They will get filled out as we go, so there's nothing to see there at the moment. The important thing is on the left side. The steps followed here are the workflow for creating an FIR filter. So we're going to begin with step one, which is to load some data from a measurement we've performed. And clicking the load button takes us to a dialog box. And you'll see two things have appeared. Here in the first top left window is the impulse response of that measurement. On the right side, in red trace, the magnitude, and the green is the phase. It automatically scales the size of the window for you. The next set of buttons are involved with adjusting the position of the impulse response relative to zero in this window. The max to zero button will move the highest level in the impulse response automatically to zero. But notice over here on the right side of this top left window, there's some information that's wrapping around on the display. We need to adjust that. In this software, if you hold the control button and move your mouse over the area you want to see closer, you can zoom in and you'll see better what's going on. The next set of buttons are used to shift the impulse response. The number indicates the number of samples each time you click one of these buttons. For our purposes, I'm going to put in one sample and start shifting one sample at a time to the right. Information that was on the left side of the impulse is now displayed. As I move it, you'll also see on the right side over here that the phase trace is moving at the same time. So we'll back it up to about there. If you felt you made any major mistakes so far, you can always hit this X. And the pop-up tells you this will clear all the time shifting that we've done. So if I hit X, it'll go back to exactly where we were in the beginning, and I could repeat this process if I felt I needed to redo it. And I should mention, as you shift it around, it's showing you how many milliseconds and samples have been shifted from the original position. All right, once you have the impulse lined up, then the next choice you have is to window the measurement. And this is to remove reflections from that measurement. You have four multi-zone time windows, and you have a Hanning 50%, which you'll probably find many times is the most helpful. And that's because you can put in exactly the number of samples for the length of the window, and it'll show you how many milliseconds that represents. So this can be adjusted by clicking through it or typing in a value that works for this particular application. Once you hit set, a window will pop up to make sure you got what you wanted. If you didn't already notice, this display changed up here in the top right. If you're not sure you caught that, hit no and try it again. If you like what you've gotten as a result, you hit yes and it'll be set that way. If you made a complete mistake there and it's really not what you wanted, you would have to go back and reload the file and align it again. The second step in Filter Hose is to choose the filter target. Push this radio button and you'll have a menu, a drop-down. Right next to that is a help item that gives you a list of all the different kinds of predefined targets that are contained in Filter Hose. There's a lot more detail on each of those in the manual, but this is a good quick reference. From the drop-down, flat magnitude linear is already selected. This is going to let us adjust the magnitude, but not adjust the phase. In this little window that pops up, we set the parameters to adjust the flat magnitude. Notice that the first choice is to set the target nominal level. That's this black line that runs straight across the display. If that's hard to see, Let me run that up a little bit just so you can see it better. We're going to move that down to a point where it intersects the graph about where we want to make our adjustments. Down here, we have choices to adjust the frequency range. And we don't need to adjust this one necessarily at 100 Hz, maybe a little higher at 300. So we'll click up to that value, or just simply type in 300, and then adjust the right side of the frequency range out to a point where it's intersecting the red graph, in this case at 24,000 Hz. Just below this, you might find this is a handy tool. If the right side display is getting a little cluttered with your phase trace, sometimes you'll want to turn that off temporarily with this checkbox and then turn it back on. After the nominal level is adjusted where you want it and the frequency bandwidth is adjusted where you want it, just make sure that the blue shaded area contains all of the data that you want to adjust. So if you want to adjust all of these changes in magnitude, just make sure this blue box is big enough. Currently, it's definitely big enough, but even if it was this small, it would be fine. Press Set, and now the middle displays show the impulse response and the idealized filter curve. Notice here the green line, almost a little hard to see, is perfectly straight because that indicates that our target does not adjust the phase, but only adjusts magnitude. In step 3, we edit the filter with this third radio button to set the filter tap. There are a few different window choices. We'll get to that in a moment. But the first thing you'll want to do probably is to adjust the tap length according to the hardware or the software that you use. Let's look at a larger value. You'll notice that this blue shaded region has gotten larger. It can be shifted to 0, it can be centered, or by samples moved around manually. Other windows just present different shapes to the blue area. We'll leave the rectangular on for now. Once you've set up those parameters, press Set and you're ready to convolve. And you'll see that happen very quickly. That's because the fast calculation checkbox is selected. This uses a quicker algorithm to get you a quick result. I'm going to uncheck that, and you'll notice this progress bar at the bottom is working on a more accurate result. There's also a checkbox here for max to 0. That simply aligns the impulse response at 0 here. So now that it has done the longer calculation, you can see on the right side that this very flat magnitude response that we were shooting for has occurred, and it has more detail in it than the quick version. Finally, we're ready to export the filter. That's the fifth radio button, and there are three choices: for a wave file, a comma separated values file, or a proprietary mini DSP file. Choose the one you need, select Export, and place that file wherever is convenient for you.